Good morning, Oak Gardens Church. Thank you so much for joining us here. We're so happy that you decided to join us here. We are ready to give God glory. We may be separated in flesh, but we're never separated with God. Listen, the Bible says whether two or three are gathered in his name, he's in the midst. Even if you're by yourself, listen, God is still by your side. We come to encourage you today, and we're glad to be in the house of God and in your house where the Spirit dwells as well. Listen, let's go into prayer because we're going to go into worship and we're going to listen to the word, and we hope that you are inspired and encouraged in this time that God has separated us in the flesh. God, we thank you so much. Thank you so much for grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your love. Thank you for peace that surpasses all understanding, things that we don't know what's going on. We don't know what's going on. We have your word that have bring forth life and bring forth fruit. And we thank you so much, God, that you have given to us such a peaceful spirit in the time of turmoil. We love you today. We honor you. We bless your name. As we go into praise and worship, please inhabit in our praise, inhabit in our worship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Water, you turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. Yeah. None like you. Yes. Into the darkness you shine. Yeah. And out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. There's none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, into the darkness you shine, and out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. There's none like you, yes. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God is greater, our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God is.
And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against?
And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us?
It is now time for the communion. This is the time that we reflect back on the death, burial, and the resurrection, and most of all, the sacrifice that our Lord and Savior, our Master Jesus Christ, offered on our behalf. As we take this bread, it reminds us of the body that he gave up. And as we take this cup, it reminds us of the blood that he shed for atonement, for sanctification, for freedom, for each believer who will believe in him. For reading's sake, we want to read Matthew chapter 26 to even understand what Jesus did when he took that bread and took that cup and reconstituted the Passover meal to say, now I am the Passover lamb and I'm going to give up my life so that you can do this in remembrance of me. We understand in Acts chapter 20, verse number 7, even after Jesus had gone back and ascended into heaven, that the believers continued this practice every first day of the week to remember his death, burial, and resurrection. Can we pray together? Father God, thank you for the bread, which represents your body. Thank you for the cup, which represents your blood. As we commune together, help us to not worry about exactly what we're taking, but why we are taking what we're taking, because of the sacrifice you gave to each one of us. Please forgive us of our sins. In your son's name we do pray.
You are worthy. And no one can worship you for me. For all the things you've done for me. And no one can worship you for me. Here's my worship, all of my worship. Receive my worship, all of my worship.
We understand the concept of Jesus offering his life for us, and we accept the gift. The challenge is sometimes the Lord asks us, what are we willing to offer? And your sacrifice is your worship. Actually, the word worship is the word worthsight, which actually says, in your worship, what is Christ's sacrifice worth to you? That's why giving is so important, that we give as God has blessed us to receive. And the beauty of giving is God never asks for anything from you and I that he hasn't already deposited in us. So as we consider giving, there are multiple ways that you can give. Even being stuck on this furlough that we are forced to endure here with this COVID-19 virus, we still can give because the church is still giving to those who are in need by helping with children who don't have a lunch plan, by helping our seniors who are widows indeed. We are still pouring out into the community because God has poured into us. You're going to see on the screen here in a minute multiple ways to give. You can give by simply texting this number 972-372-9520. You can text the word give and then it will prompt you on how to give. You can go to PayPal and give under the church name of Oak Gardens Church. You can even go to the website oakgardenschurch.org and you can give on different platforms. And if you're having any trouble there, you can definitely contact or email jmetlin@oakgardenschurch.org and we can walk you through the process. But let me tell you something. If you've lost your job, if you don't have the ability to give, God is not asking for you something he hadn't deposited in you. That's our time to support you and encourage you as you move forward. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for the opportunity to offer to you because you offered to us. We only give because you have given to us, but also we recognize the greatest gift you ever gave was your son, Jesus Christ. That's why John 3:16 is so important. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And it really is a testimony of how much we respect what you gave by us giving something back to you to show the respect we have for the ultimate sacrifice that you blessed us to have. Thank you for this time of offering. In your son's name we do pray. And all who believe said amen. Let's give together right now.
You, Lord, you are worthy,
and no one
can worship you for me.
For all the
things you've done for me,
and you consistently do, yes.
And no one can worship you.
Here's my word.
worship.
All of my worship.
No matter what's going on.
Raising my worship.
All of my worship.
As long as
I am breathing, I will always worship you.
And I will
not be silent.
I will
always worship you.
As long as
I am breathing, I will always worship you.
Once again, we are so thanking God that you were able to join in via technology, and we praise God for the opportunity to even worship together being at home. I want to continue our study for the next 3 weeks. We're going to look at the subject divine disruption. In Acts chapter 8, all the way to Acts chapter 9, there were divine disruptions that took place. One disruption was the disciples and the apostles in Jerusalem had to spread out. The apostles stayed there, but the disciples had to go into Samaria and Judea because they had a purpose to fulfill. But then after that, we see a divine disruption with a eunuch, a Ethiopian eunuch. Isn't it amazing that the gospel was spread even to Africa, the birthplace of all humanity, that the news of Jesus Christ made it even to Africa in the first century. But also there was a divine disruption with this new character we're about to research in the Bible. His name was Saul, but now his name is Paul, and he was received a divine disruption from God to change his direction. But today, we want to look at Acts chapter 8. Y'all get your Bibles out, or your tablets, or your phone, or whatever, and pull this up, and let's look real quick together. In Acts chapter 8, verse number 9, the Bible says, a man named Simon had a sorcerer there for many years, amazing the people of Samaria and claiming to be someone great. Everyone from the least to the greatest often spoke of him as being the great one, the power of God. They listened closely to him because for a long time he had astounded them, catch this, with miracles and magic. But now the people believe Philip's message of the good news concerning the kingdom of God and believing in the name of Jesus Christ. As a result, many men and women were baptized. Then Simon himself even believed and was baptized. He began following Philip wherever he went, and he was amazed by the signs and the miracles that Philip was able to perform. Divine disruption. Let's pray. Father God, as we study your word, help it to penetrate our hearts, help it to change our minds, but most of all, help it to change our direction. Please forgive us of our sins. In your son's name, we do pray. And all who believe said, amen. About 3 or 4 months ago, I was trying to fly back out from Charleston, South Carolina. And on my way back, I got on the plane Sunday night. I had a flight coming back to Dallas at 9 o'clock Sunday night from Charleston, South Carolina. I finally got on the plane at 11 o'clock, frustrated, upset, exhausted after preaching 3 times, got on the plane, and the captain of the plane came on and said, listen, We're going to sit on the tarmac for at least 50 minutes because there is a storm over DFW Airport that we have to wait to move off because they have a backlog of flights hovering over DFW. And when it clears up, we'll take off. I was exhausted, sleepy, frustrated, because normally I get into bed about 7 o'clock, but this time I had to stay up and stay alert. But God allowed a divine disruption because the man next to me, while we were sitting on the tarmac, started having tears coming down his eyes. And the reason, he had just left a funeral that he had been involved with his mother in South Carolina. On their way back, he had a shaky relationship with God, and we were able, because there was nothing else to do in that hot plane, nowhere to go, for 50 minutes, I was able to sit there and talk to him about the good news of Jesus Christ. You know, sometimes God will disrupt you because he has something for you to do. Sometimes we get so busy in life, moving from here to there, that we miss the move of God and what God is trying to do in our lives. C.S. Lewis said it like this, the great theologian said it like this, interruptions are not obstacles to our plan. They are opportunities for us to embrace God's plan. Let me give that to you again. That's, if you don't get anything else, I want you to get that. Look what C.S. Lewis says. Interruptions are not obstacles to our plan. They are opportunities for us to embrace God's plan. Sometimes God will bring forth a disruption for you to discredit your plan and get on to his plan. It's what William Blackaby says in his book, In Spiritual Leadership. William Blackaby said that most of us waste our spiritual journey trying to manipulate God to get on our agenda, and the whole time God is trying to force us to get on his agenda. Maybe this COVID-19 situation this year is helping us to slow down, to stop, to stay still, and see the move of God. Just think about it. When we look at Acts chapter 8, we see people who are in tune with what God is doing. Had it been us, and we would have received Jesus Christ in Jerusalem and then start getting persecution in Jerusalem, we would have said, what is this God thing all about? But they saw that since we accepted God, we also accept the plan of God. So there are three highlights that we want to look at today as we start this series of divine interruptions. First of all, divine interruptions are designed to fulfill assignments. Catch this again. It'll come up on your screen. Divine interruptions are designed to fulfill divine assignments. Look at Philip. Philip here is being forced out of Jerusalem. He's the same Philip who was named with Stephen in Acts chapter 6, of being one of the great servants of the first church. And as Philip gets this assignment, because of the death and the persecution of Stephen, Philip has to go out, and he ends up in Samaria. And while in Samaria, he runs into two individuals. He runs into this dude by the name of Simon, who was a magician, a sorcerer type of a person. And then he also runs into this Ethiopian eunuch. Many times we miss our divine assignment because we're so busy fighting the move of God that we don't see that sometime God will disrupt us over here to get us to where he wants us to be, because he has an assignment for our lives. He has an assignment for somebody who needs to hear Jesus in our lives. Think about it this week. How many of you have spent more time with your neighbors than you have since you've lived there? It might be because God wants you to share Jesus Christ with them. Some of us have called our family members more this week, just checking on them because of what's going on in the world. It might be because God wants you to share Jesus with them. Some of us are having to work from home, and we're having to talk to coworkers more than we ever have. Sometimes God will disrupt your normal so that you can become abnormal for them to receive an abnormal God. It's sometimes God will disrupt you over here so he can position you, because somebody needs to hear the Jesus that you have. And that's what Philip did in Acts chapter 8. Philip left Jerusalem, ended up in Samaria, and during that process, he was able to bless Simon with the word of God and this Ethiopian eunuch. But not only does divine interruptions are designed to fulfill assignments, catch this, divine interruptions are designed to expose truth. That's good stuff. Divine interruptions are designed to expose truth. Let me give it to you like this. The word of God has come alive to me while going through this dark period of isolation. The word of God, I mean, when you look at Psalms 46, when it says he is a present help in the time of trouble. And in verse number 10, it says, so in if you know all this is going on and God is in charge of it, he says, be still and just watch God. I mean, those texts mean something to me on a good day, but when I'm really going through, they come alive to me when I'm going through. That's what Philip is doing here. Philip is exposing the word of God to people who are living in darkness, and in the process of them living in darkness, God has blessed them to see the light, because the Bible says that the people in the city believed the word, and much joy came to a city that was considered an outcast, an outlying city, and a worthless city. I've told this story before, but years ago, back in 2003, when my wife was in the hospital, they told us that first day that when she had to go through that cancer treatment, we had just found out that she had cancer, they said that she is very sick. She is very sick. And if she can make it into the morning, then we have hope to treat her sickness. But the night is going to be touch and go all night long. But if she can make it to by 6 o'clock, we might have a chance to start giving her chemo to help her make it through this tough sickness that she has. You know, the word of God, different verses started coming to me that night. And when the sun came up, I really understood that weeping may endure for a night, but you know the rest of it. Joy comes in the morning. It's something about God putting you in tight situations so he can raise up in you what he has deposited in you to grow through you so that you can have stability even in a disrupted situation. So first of all, Philip does this for us. Philip, first of all, he is in position for a divine fulfillment. What does God have for you to do that you keep fighting? I'm letting you answer. What does God have for you that you keep running away from? I did it for years, trying to run away from preaching. I vowed never to be a preacher, and everything I did failed until I did what God wanted me to do. It's something God has assigned for you to do. But then also, God loves to expose truth in you in dark places. Do you not know light shines better when it's surrounded by darkness? That some of us have become so busy that we can't see truth, because we keep our minds occupied with technology and work and friends and family, that we don't sit still enough to be exposed by the truth of who God is. But here's my last point before you fall asleep on me. I see you falling asleep. Get off that couch and stay with me. Here's my last thing I want to give you. Not only does God allow divine interruptions are designed to fulfill divine assignments, and not only does divine interruptions are designed to expose truth. Here's your go home where you're already at home. Here's your go to bed. It's divine interruptions are also designed to redirect. Catch this again. Divine interruptions are also designed to redirect. You got two things going on here. You got one guy by the name of Simon who are doing magic, are doing miracles for his glory. But then you got the child of God, the evangelist Philip, who is doing miracles for God's glory. The reason Simon wanted this was for him to gain more money. The reason Philip was doing magic, or doing miracles better yet, was doing miracles was for God to gain more believers in Jesus Christ. Catch this. Anything you do on assignment, if it is for you, is not for God. Everything you and I do is for God's glory. That when we help others, even through this COVID-19 situation, it's not for you to get somebody to come on Facebook and say you're great. No, it's for you to expose those who are living in darkness to Jesus, who is that marvelous light. Don't help people because you can. Help people because God helped you. That sometimes God will redirect your step so your purpose will change. When Philip and Peter and John, who traveled from Jerusalem down to see what was going on in Samaria, because so many people had started believing in Jesus Christ, and they wanted to see this miraculous change of this city themselves. When they finally got down there, they met Simon and found out that his heart wasn't right, his spirit wasn't right. He wanted to do miracles for his glory, but they said, this is not for sale. In fact, what you're doing is going to send you to hell. He says, you need to change your heart, you need to change your life, and you need to change your step. The Bible says, Simon said, please pray for me. Please help those evil spirits to come out of me so I can truly serve a risen Savior. That when you have a disruption in life, it's for you to get on assignment for God. It's for you to expose the truth that's inside of you. But not only that, it's for you and I to redirect our steps, for us to share Jesus with others, share the truth of Jesus with others. And this is a great time to really share the good news of Jesus. We're talking to neighbors that we've never talked to before. We're talking to family members who might have rekindled their relationship after 20 years of hurt. We're talking to coworkers now because everybody is having to work from home. And even sometimes disruptions will even bless you to expose the inadequacies in you. Let me give you a case in point. We found out today that Ellis County was going to shut down tonight. We had planned to take this tomorrow. So what I had to do was run by the house, get me a shirt, but what you don't see is what's wrong with me under the shirt. I have shorts on because it's hot here in Dallas, Texas. Let me tell you what God would do. God will give you a tight shot just to show how good you look when you actually know that you are not complete. That God will even disrupt you to expand the camera to stop showing just the good part of you, but to expose the all of you so you can get right with God. Hey, some of us like to have Facebook lives, but we need to have some lives that have our face in His book. And guess what it'll do? It'll expand your borders, it'll expand your life, and it'll expand everything that's going on in your life so that God can get the glory. Don't let this disruption that's happening in our world make you and I miss what God is still doing in the world. People are coming to Christ by the droves because we can't depend on money. We can't depend on the government. Sure enough, with the leaders we have, Winston Churchill said that bad leadership is exposed in times of trauma. And we can see that right now. You can't even trust on your job. You're going to get that stimulus package and you can't wait for it, but you can't even hold on to that. The only thing you can hold on to is God's unchanging hand. And maybe He's disrupting our lives so that we can get on God's agenda and stop trying to force God to get on our agenda. I hope this lesson blessed you. To next week, if God allows us to come back and do this again, we'll look at this brother, this Ethiopian eunuch. Oh, I can't wait to get to him because he takes the message of Jesus back to the motherland, back to Mesopotamia, back to the origin of the human race out of Africa. And I can't wait to talk to us next week about the divine interruption that God has for our life. May God bless you and keep you is our prayer.
I love to praise Him. I love to praise His name. I love to praise Him. I love to praise His name. I love to praise His name. I love to praise.
pray together as we close out this service. Father God, please give us divine disruptions so that we can see your divine purpose in our lives. Help us to live a purposeful life. Help us to live a life on purpose. And even in these disruptions in life, help it to expose truth in us. Help it to expose life in us, but also help it to expose the assignment that you have for each one of us to do so that we can compel men and women to come to Jesus Christ. Thank you for these times. Thank you for this opportunity to even share Jesus in a time of distress, because we know you're the only one that can take the stress out of distress when we put Christ in our lives. Please forgive us of our sins. Thank you for the Old Gardens Church, all the family and friends that are watching this. Bless us now. Bless us to trust in you. In your Son's name we do pray. And all who believe said amen. Hey, God bless you and keep you. Can't wait to see you next week. You'll be getting stuff from the church. Pray that you will log on, that you will look at Facebook, that you will check our church team app and get involved, because we want to continue to do life together. May God bless you and keep you, is our prayer.